Now coming upon us here in June, the great American bash throughout this country, starting in Lakeland, Florida, finishing in the Orange Bowl of Miami. First things first, though, before Ric Flair comes into my picture, and that is the fact that Tully Blanchard, J.J. Dillon, owe me $100,000, which they stole from me. Now, in Tampa, Florida, Tuesday night in the Sun Dome, the American Dusty Rhodes is coming back for the gathering, if you will, coming home to take care of business in a steel cage. Tully Blanchard owed me $100,000, or at least $100,000 of his hide. And before I go any further with it, I want the people to see what kind of thief Tully Blanchard is and J.J. Dillon is and what happened to me in the Greensboro Coliseum June the 6th.
JJ's got the money! J.J. Dillon has taken that bag of money! And he's walking out! There he goes! There's your bell! What's Tommy Young? What's the match to continue? And Dusty has chased J.J. out of the building. There he goes after the money! And Tommy Young here is calling Dusty back. Why is the match to continue? What's going on? Oh, no! Tommy Young wanted the match to continue for some unknown reason and now has given the match to Tully Blanchard. Magnum Dusty's out of the parking lot looking for J.J.
You got that in Texas, be real simple. We'd hang somebody, you know what I mean? When they stole a man's money. I'm gonna take it out of your hide. Tuesday night in the Sun Dome. Tully Blanchard, J.J. Dillon, the great American Bash Adonis, and you're right. The head of the family has come back. Bobby Jack back here live today on this television. Bugsy McGraw, a man I hold dear to me. We held the United States Challenge Cup. We won that tournament. Now back together, the cream of the crop, the greatest athletes in the world return to CWF because the National Wrestling Alliance, Dusty Rhodes, and the power of Jim Crockett Promotions now dictate wrestling in this country. And Tuesday night, Tully Blanchard in the Sun Dome, Dusty Rhodes wants his $100,000. And I'm going to take it in that cage out of your hide, Daddy, because this is the Funky Like a Monkey Tour, 1987. Thank you, God.
Okay, Dusty, thank you so very, very much. The American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And, of course, wherever you see him, you see the optimum in wrestling excitement. Well, let's go to the...
Gordon, this is my time. This is my...
He's got no business out here.
I'd like to know what this big, gas bag bear is doing here on my time.
Let me tell you something, folks.
I don't like you or your scummy brother, Terry. I'll stand anywhere I want to, anytime I want to.
Don't call my brother scummy.
Hey, wait a minute. Terry. Hold on.
On the road, stories about things that happened after the matches, before the matches, on the way to the arena. But everybody knows the late Dick Murdoch, God rest his soul, my main man. We were partners for a long time. And that was a time, I'm going to tell you things that only your ears will hear from me and nowhere else. That was time for, well, Dick Murdoch would, I believe this or not, get on my nerves. You know what I'm saying? And I finally, we were in Detroit, Michigan. And this was in 1970. And I was sitting there with Dick Murdoch. I said, I'm leaving here. And how did you leave an area back then? You went and gave a notice. So I got up and I went into this little room, and that was Jack Kane. He was the matchmaker, if you will. And the Sheik was there against Wild Bull Curry. And this place was sold out. Me and Murdoch were there against two guys that we beat so bad I can't even remember the names. And you say, I'm getting senile? No, it ain't. So I went in there and I say, you know, I'm going to give my 2-week notice. I look around and Murdoch is standing right there next to me. And he didn't understand that I wanted to split off by myself. So in good conscience, though, I went ahead and me and Murdoch, and we went down to Florida. And we had a suit of clothes apiece that we had bought. That's probably the last time we had a suit together on as we went down to Florida and started our careers down there. And as you know, I went on to become the American Dream right there in the state of Florida. And you're seeing many great tapes here today. Promised you something special, didn't I?
Wow. McGraw is wild and unpredictable, a man as you'd ever want to meet. Joining me now at the podium is Sir Oliver Humperdinck and Dory Funk Jr.
Bugsy McGraw is back in the area, but what I want to talk about now is that no good cattle thief, that no good big goose-shirt Blackjack Mulligan. Let me tell you something, Mulligan, it started right where it left off. Where each other's throats again, and I like it like that. But you're going to have to pay some heavy dues, and I'm talking about tomorrow night in Orlando, because it's all coming down to this.
I have been 15 minutes back there in the dressing room trying to stop the bleeding from the face claw of Blackjack Mulligan. Now, would you people figure out how in the world does anybody cut you open with a face claw? He's got to have something on the glove. And I swear by my brother Terry Funk, tomorrow night in Orlando, for every drop of my blood that spilled, and there was a lot of drops of blood, I'm going to spill a gallon of Blackjack Mulligan's blood.
Well, he told everybody out here on this very program that they keep their hands off of me. Well, Mulligan, you might not have been in the area then, but you're going to find out tomorrow night in Orlando that once you put your hands on me, you're going to have to answer to this man right here. And in Orlando, tomorrow night, Mulligan, I'm going to relish every minute, every second of the time that Dory Funk Jr. punishes you and makes you scream. I'm going to take great delight in watching you beat that big drugstore cowboy all around that Eddie Graham Sports Complex.
May I ask you a question, Sir Oliver? Where is Kevin Sullivan?
Don't worry about Kevin Sullivan. He's a little confused. He's a little dazed right now. Having Blackjack Mulligan out here was your idea, and you knew it would set Sullivan off, didn't you?
You better be.
Well, you're part of the conspiracy too, so you better watch your back, Gordon Sully.
Tomorrow night in Orlando.
Well, all right. I guess they've made their point. Want to take a moment now to talk further to J.J. Dillon, because Dusty Rhodes made it very obvious, my friend, that he believes you and Tully Blanchard flat stole $100,000 from him.
Gordon Sully, I'm not a very happy man. All throughout my career, I've been called a lot of things, but the one thing that I've been called by everybody is a gentleman. And the last thing that I've been called is a thief. And I take exception to anybody who would even imply that I'm a thief or even thought about being a thief. Now, Dusty Rhodes, you come out here and you show a videotape where you imply that you are now the world television champion or should be the title holder. Did the foot go over just before 3? Was it right at 3? Was it right after 3? That's not important. I thought the foot went over before 3. You jumped up thinking you had won the match. Well, I took the money, yes. But you're not a thief when you take something that belongs to you. And the referee didn't quite see it like you did, because when all the dust settled, he raised the hand of Tully Blanchard, declared him still be champion, and the $100,000 was his, which means it was ours. Now, Tuesday, you're talking about the Sun Dome taking out all that money off Mr. Blanchard's hide. And I see what's happening. I'm no fool. All of a sudden, Blackjack Mulligan, nobody's seen him for a long time, he comes out of the woodwork. Bugsy McGraw, an old crony of yours, he comes out of the woodwork, all rallying around your side. And I know what you got planned in that cage match Tuesday in the Sun Dome. But, Mr. Rhodes, let me remind you of something. The Four Horsemen are all going to be here Tuesday night, too. That's right. the World Heavyweight Champion, Nature Boy Ric Flair, Mr. Lex Luger, the Total Package, and Arn Anderson, the Enforcer. We're all going to be here. So maybe the War Games, maybe the Match Beyond might take place a little early right here in Tampa Tuesday. We'll see you in the cage.
Thank you so very much, Mr. J.J. Dillon, refuting the claims of Dusty Rhodes. Let's go to the ring, please. All right, the Florida...
Time, or point in time, had great leaders. And professional wrestling was no different than in it. The greatest visionary of pro wrestling ever in the history, even to this date, was Eddie Graham, my mentor. And Eddie had a vision of stepping out of Florida into a global network. And in 1982, he globalized, if you will, Florida Championship Wrestling. And in taking a look next month at what happened and things that came about because of this, you will see wrestling start to change as Eddie sees this vision. We will see Barry Windham in a Southern heavyweight title match against Dusik. You'll hear Roddy Piper and Magnum T.A. special look at this young man that became such a huge star. And we all know Barry Windham went on to stardom, and right now we know Barry is the man they call the Stalker. So this is Dusty Rhodes for Turnbuckle Memories.
On the road! And I'm on the road of a dirty dog by the name of Dusty Rhodes. And I'm going to chase him down like a dirty dog that it is if I have to go all over the South, New Orleans, Mississippi, even in the state of Georgia. Like I told you once before, I'm going to be like Sherman, march to the sea, because I want what's mine, brother. And what's mine is mine. I weigh 325 pounds. If you ever saw a man 325 pounds upset, let me tell you. It's a sight to see, and Dusty Rhodes, you the cause of it, and I'm going to follow you, and I'm going to catch you, brother, because I got my traveling clothes on. And when I get you, brother, you're going to hear the sound of the whistle. You're going to hear it, and you're going to hear it wherever it is. Tomorrow night in Atlanta, Georgia, in the Omni, it all come to pass, brother. It all come true. You sign the contract to meet the biggest man in wrestling today. And I'm going to take what's mine, brother. And I'm going to do anything it takes to get it. So beware, because it might take place in the parking lot. Dusty Rhodes, you belong.
World, six times world heavyweight wrestling champion Harley Race and the American Dream, former world heavyweight champion, collide for the world title. It's going to be a tremendous contest. The odds makers are saying that Harley Race is finished. However, he is six times world heavyweight champion. No way can you count this man out. And yet, the tremendous drive, the tremendous desire of the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, is yet to be reckoned with. Let's go now as we watch these two contestants enter the ring. Being made now. Harley Race, six times world heavyweight champion, moving into the ring. Dusty Rhodes, the former world heavyweight champion, and what a contest. Dusty Rhodes, as you can hear by the tremendous cheer of the crowd here at the beautiful Omni in Atlanta, Georgia. And now, six times world heavyweight champion Harley Race being introduced. Harley Race, a man, very, very unpopular, as you can hear by the crowd, a very unpopular competitor, but he is, in no question, he is one of the greatest world heavyweight champions the National Wrestling Alliance has ever known. Here's a man who at age 17 began his professional career. 1 year later, was so severely injured in an automobile train crash that they said he would never walk again, far less ever even think of wrestling again. now come back to become six times world heavyweight champion. And all you can say there is this man has to have tremendous integrity, personal integrity, tremendous drive, tremendous self-sacrifice. But he's also facing a man who had three opportunities in professional sports, professional baseball, as a shortstop, believe it or not. And he's tipped those scales tonight at around 260 pounds. But Dusty Rhodes was offered that career, a career in pro football, or a career in pro wrestling, and he is fired up. Dusty Rhodes is fired up, and the crowd has caught the electricity. A quick side headlock by the world heavyweight champion, Harley Race. Dusty Rhodes reversing that situation, gets a side headlock. As Race, Trapp momentarily comes off the rope. Beautiful high hip toss by Rhodes. Comes down with an elbow. Rhodes out of the Race out of the way. That time he caught Race. And so we could see the tide of this battle turning very, very quickly indeed. And as we have said so many times on Championship Wrestling, a title, any title, because of the keenness of the competition right now, could change hands in the twinkling of an eye. When I say the twinkling of an eye, I'm talking about the free count. Once again, collar and elbow, Dusty Rhodes getting a side headlock on the world heavyweight champion, Harley Race. Keeping the pressure on now with the side headlock. Race, both men in black trunks, by the way. Rhodes wearing the white knee guards. Race wearing the black knee guards. Both men, battled veterans of the ring wars. Race, of course, who has wrestled over half of his adult life. Backs away, but then catches him with a shoulder coming in. A reversal by Rhodes. Rhodes catches him with an elbow. Staggers. Rhodes goes for the sleeper hold. Rhodes goes for the sleeper hold. He's going for a quick concession here. Looking for a quick submission. And Race in dire straits now. Race has got himself a whole handful of problems. The World Heavyweight Championship slipping from his grasp at this point in time. It may be all over for Harley Race, the World Heavyweight Champion. Dusty Rhodes. No, sir. Race turned into him, got him into the ropes. And again, you see the tremendous inventiveness, the genius, if you will, of this man, Harley Race. Six times world heavyweight champion. So many times he has turned what looks like an absolute victory. Race using that headbutt, but it was Rhodes with an elbow that caught Race, and Race now is in trouble. Race is in trouble, and Dusty Rhodes reveling now in his own glory as he realizes he's got the champion up. No, he doesn't either. He's got a side headlock now. Deep into the match now, and it is still Dusty Rhodes and Harley Race, and neither man able to gain a pinfall or a submission over the other. But what two fantastic athletes we've seen in action here. And Race now, perhaps, dipping deep down inside by the set Rhodes hand. A vertical souffle by Harley Race, the world heavyweight champion. And Harley Race now moving up on that second ring rope, and Harley Race, who uses his body as a human battering ram, knocks down on Dusty Rhodes, catching him on the temple on the shoulder. Race very quickly moves in a lateral press. Just
because just like I said, I had nothing to be ashamed.
Period of time we had become very close friends. However, something has happened, and I hate to be the bearer of bad tidings, but I have a letter from the NWA that I want to relate to you at this time. And it is to Championship Wrestling 84 regarding the situation existing between Mr. Kevin Sullivan and Dusty Rhodes, a.k.a. the Midnight Rider. Both men are now facing possible suspension for their behavior in the ring. Dusty, I'm sorry to be the one to bring you that kind of information.
Well, God, like I told you, on many occasions, the Midnight Rider and Dusty Rhodes are two separate people. Now, the karma that's come over my house from day one, when I came out here with my sister, and from day one when Kevin Sullivan put the karma over my house, then whatever exists between me and him is going to happen. And I want you to take a look. You talk about suspending me or the Midnight Rider or Dusty Rhodes. I want you to take a look, and this thing speaks for itself right here, baby. And you talk about what's going to come down on the house of Kevin Sullivan. We're going to take a look right here at what he called the golden fight.
Thank you.
anything possible suspense.
Well, let me tell you just real plainly to you, and let me tell the championship wrestling of Florida and everybody else involved. This thing has started. It was brought down on me and my family. It's brought down on Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, the Child Power. All I'm going to say to Kevin Sullivan is that this thing right here is not over. I got 5 stitches in my chest. I mean, knocked out cooler than a wet cow hitting the ground. So whatever's going to go right now, I'm going to take care of. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to tell Championship Wrestling from Florida, I'm going to tell Buddy Coach, and I'm going to tell everybody, I really don't give a damn what the NWA thinks. So if they want to suspend me, I'm going to give them something to suspend me for. Because that's what it's all about. This is what it's all about. So if you want to suspend me, if you want to run me out the state, you know where I live, baby. You come and get a hold of Dusty Rhodes.
Well, I, for one, certainly can't say I blame him at all, but something has got to stop. The situation is going to happen.
Well, here comes the match that we've all been waiting for. And it's one fall, 5 minute time limit, in the far corner, 2 times World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Dusty Rhodes. His opponent is the unknown Purple Haze. He's accompanied to the ring by Kevin Sullivan. Psychology of one and the muscular talents and ability rather combined
However, I still think it takes 3-4 good men to get on an even keel when you're going against Dusty Rhodes. And, as I said before, 2-time world champion. That exhibits a special quality. Now here comes Christopher Allen's back.
You see, look at the agility for a man the size of Dusty, 290 pounds, and moves like a lightweight. He has the Purple Haze tied up in the ring rope. The Purple Haze right now is virtually helpless. Fortunately for Dusty Rhodes, Blackjack Mulligan is here, or Kevin Sullivan would be interfering. Kevin Sullivan staying well back because of the appearance. Here's the Purple Haze just dragging Dusty Rhodes out onto the floor. The match is being carried outside onto the floor now.
Boy, this is one of the toughest matches I have witnessed many, many years. It's not the roughest, the toughest.
Oh, wait. Molokai just handed something to Kevin Sullivan. Kevin Sullivan, a
he's got the figure four on him, and that's Roach. The leg of Panama Jack. And the referee, Bill Alfonso, is calling for a disqualification of Purple Haze. What in the world did he do there?
Kevin Sullivan pulled something out of that box, and it seemed like he got right in the chest. I see there's a lot of blood coming from the chest of Blackjack Mulligan. Dusty Rhodes put this figure four leg lock on the Purple Haze, which was the hole that he injured the Panama Gang, which put the Panama Gang out. Kevin Sullivan was handed something in a box from Molokai, the man he calls Molokai. Kevin Sullivan moved up, looks like he was attempting to attack Dusty Rhodes, and Blackjack Mulligan stepped into the ring, stepped in to try and help Dusty to counteract this, and thusly, Blackjack got this in the chest, and here is Kevin Sullivan back at the desk.
The match here on television that ends up as a total disaster for the one-man gang.
Well, it really did. It seemed like the ligaments were torn in the one-man gang's knee and the leg there, and he was out of action for just about 2 months where he couldn't participate in wrestling at all.
Here, what we're going to do, just to give you an indication of the kind of resiliency this man does have, though, let's go back in time now again. This time, about 4 months ago, when Dusty Rhodes faced the 450-pound one-man gang here on Championship Wrestling.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match went forward 18 minutes time limit. Introducing first in Chicago, Illinois, 450-pound one-man gang. His opponent, entering the ring from Tampa, Florida, weighing at 260 pounds, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes. Ooh, Rhodes down on that knee again. And it looks to me like the one-man gang has got some pretty serious damage to that knee.
You know, Gordon, this here is the same hole that Mad Dog Bob Sawyer broke Ray Harris' leg with just a couple weeks ago. This is a damaging hole. There is virtually no escaping once this hole is applied in the center of the ring. One of the very few holes for which there is no counter.
Well, it was a hole that Eddie Graham used and perfected. And I'll tell you what, it has proven to be so highly effective. And it is apparent here that the one-man gang is not able to walk. While the ligaments of the cartilage, possibly in that knee, have been ripped or have been stretched to a point where that's 450 pounds that they're going to have to try and load up on a stretcher. And they're trying to, and he is in tremendous pain, as you can tell. He can't even stand to have anybody touch him, but they've got to get him up on that stretcher. Those are the comments of Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream. And there's the beat.
Join me at the desk. He's just seen his leg broken by Dusty Rhodes. Both expect and receive numerous injuries, and this man has got a reputation for never backing down from any confrontation. It was common knowledge that he was in the corner of Sir Oliver Humperdinck.
Yeah, Dusty Rhodes,
mostly my dressing room. It's my stuff that's going around. My personal goods, my valuables, my fur, my chain, all my clothes. This is, I don't, you know, like I said, I'm totally confused. I don't know what's happening. Valuables, I have to pick them up. So,
so it just caused you to make decisions about your career and what you're going to do with it?
Hey, right. Like I said, I'm lost right now. I'm confused. I don't know what's happening. All I know is two people jumped me in the ring, and I come down to my dressing room, you know, to shower up and be ready to leave, because as you can see, they laced me wide open, and the door shut. All my valuables are thrown out on the floor. You know, I'm just, I didn't understand it. I didn't know what was going on. I was just confused. I was lost. Yeah, I'm trying to get in. The door's never shut. They never shut the door. Here I am trying to get in. I don't understand it.
And you never got any chance to explain what happened?
No, I just, no explanation. No explanation. Out of my own dressing room. That's all I know. I was locked out, my stuff was thrown out. And like I said, me and Hubbard Dean could have had a few words, you know, in the past, you know, recently, but I didn't think they were this serious, but I guess they are this serious. That's the picture right there. That's all I know of, right there. That's all I know. And I'm not saying, you know, I'm not guilty of anything I've done in the past. You know, like five of us jumped Blackjack Mulligan and beat the man up severely. You know, I'm not saying I wasn't involved, but as it seems right now, you know, what goes around comes around is right there in Lakeland, Texas. You know, we just saw Billy Graham and Cowboy Ron Bass from the orders, I'm sure, of Oliver Humper being jumping from behind. And somewhere down the line, you know, I'm going to get these two men in the ring somewhere down the line, and whether it's tag, if I get me a good tag team partner, anybody, you know. I can take them on singles, but Superstar Billy Graham, Cowboy Ron Bass, Oliver Humperdinck, them three men right there, the main three men that come me from behind, they split me wide open. Them three men right there is who I'm looking for, and I know, Ms. Claire, that there's an underlying evil force much stronger than these three men. I know there's a much evil force, and I think we all know who I'm talking about. I don't have to mention any names. This man's been on the scene, you know, causing things evil to happen for a long, long time. And that night in Lakeland, you know, the evil in that dressing room, you know, with Humper Dean, Kevin Sullivan, the evil is so thick over there, you can cut it with a knife, you know. Like, I was confused all the time. I've been over there for months and months, night after night. I was confused. I didn't realize what was going on. And in Lakeland, this Saturday night, Dusty Rhodes was the first man ever to show me that I could stand on my feet like a man on my own, because I always had Humper Dean or Sullivan or somebody there saying, you know, one man gang, you do this, you do that, you know. Like, I always had like a little, they was leaning post for me, but that night was the first time ever in my life that I found out I could stand on my feet like a real man could stand on his feet.
Well, in view of the situation, Dusty Rhodes had some comments to make, you know.
And let me tell you something, gang, when the word comes down, you got thrown out of your home, your house, the dressing room. I mean, you're walking down the hall, I heard, with your equipment in your hand. Now, a few months ago when this started, when I broke your leg, I tried to tell you in a violent manner how it was between me and the family and them guys over there. See, and any time, I haven't spoken to the family about this thing, and you called for me to be your partner. Well, I've always done what I wanted to do and was who I wanted to. You know how bad I can get. You know how really mean and honor I can get. So I know one thing. If it's time for you to break loose and come right, then our family's always accepted anybody that wanted to come right. And I'm just going to make it real plain and simple. I'll be your partner. And if you're serious about coming right, you'll have a family, and you won't have a dressing room to be thrown out of. You'll have one to live in. and socialize in and be part of. But if you don't come right, and it's bad judgment on my part, Bobby ain't gonna like it. Bill ain't gonna like it. Billy Jack ain't gonna like it. And Dusty Rhodes and his sister ain't gonna like it. Cause now you know how to feel, Jetta. So I'll show up, you do your part, and the family will be ready.
Than any other university in the country, and here's one who held it for the longest time, 4.5 years. It's a pleasure to welcome back to Championship Wrestling, Dory Funk, Jr.
Well, thank you, Gordon. It's great to be back, and I have knowledge that Ric Flair, the World Heavyweight Champion, is passing through the area.
Precisely. You know, it's not too terribly long ago that Mr. Flair wrestled Dusty Rhodes in the Orange Bowl in Miami, and Dusty Rhodes defeated him for the Lord of the Rings.
Well, Gordon, according to the people in professional wrestling who know, many top-ranked promoters around the country really feel that Ric Flair will not leave the state of Florida with the World Heavyweight Championship this time. He's facing Dusty Rhodes, a tremendous athlete. Dusty Rhodes defeated Ric Flair in the Lord of the Rings. From what I understand, people say actually Dusty won 3 straight falls from Ric Flair. He's also facing Barry Windham in this area. And the people who are in really don't think he'll leave this area with the World Heavyweight Championship. But, Gordon, would you believe that over the past year, I have been challenging the great American dream, Dusty Rhodes, to a match, any kind of a match, any place. I have been chasing Dusty Rhodes all over the country, and nobody in this area even knows about it. You know why? Because Dusty Rhodes is in, politically, in professional wrestling in this area. Can you imagine? I've been chasing Dusty Rhodes, challenging Dusty Rhodes, and nobody knows about it.
Well, I am rather surprised to hear that, Mr. Funk. I would have thought for sure that information like that would come past this microphone at one point or another.
Well, you know Rhodes is a great athlete. He came out of West Texas State University. But you also know that Dusty Rhodes is afraid of the Funk family. He's afraid of my brother. He's afraid of myself. And it's just amazing to me that you people don't know that I've been challenging Dusty Rhodes for a long time.
I was smiling because here's a fellow who really wants to meet you, Billy Jack.
Hey, cool. Dory Funk, I'm sorry not to meet you, brother. But yeah, I always wanted to meet you. I met the American dream, Dusty Rhodes, when I came down here. And my days are all my heart. Dusty Rhodes, the American dream, has helped me out so much. He's a former world champion. The great Eddie Graham, you know, they're legends in the time. I just want to make it my point right now to come out and send all the people in Florida to have my hand out to you and to tell you thank you so much. Other than Dusty Rhodes, you're probably the finest athlete that ever came out of West Texas.
Emulate Dusty.
well of Kevin, and maybe Mike Davis really thinks he is Dusty Rhodes.
Well, he's got TR on the side of his front. And... well, I am completely blown away with this. The years that I've been doing championship wrestling, I've never seen anything quite as strange as that in my life. The victor, Mike Davis. Or Dusty Rhodes. Well, Mike Davis is all you can say there.
With the lock and a different Dusty Rhodes. You want to explain what?
Lots of different Dusty Rhodes. A year ago, I predicted, as Habuda Dean took me to the seventh step, on the seventh veil, he told me, darkness lives in Rhodes' heart. You and Rhodes are cosmic warriors. Together, I will draw the life force from Dusty Rhodes and put it beside you. Together, you will stand. And it took me a while to get it through to the dream. But now the dream has arisen. The dream has arrived. The dream had spent time in Singapore on Boogie Street with Habuda Dean himself. He laid on the bed of nails, fasted for 30 days, found his mind and soul in the desert. Dream, it's been a long time coming. I'm glad to have you, Big Dust.
You know, Kevin Sullivan, they say it could never be done. They said that Dusty Rhodes would never walk together with Kevin Sullivan. But as you see right here, before you with the lock, Dusty Rhodes himself, the only American dream, is right here, baby. And don't ever forget it, because I'm here to get rid of that big imposter who said he was a family. I've seen the dark side. I know where I'm coming from. And Virgil Reynolds, there is but one Dusty Rhodes. And you're looking at him right here. I am the American dream. And together with my people, Kevin Sullivan and Locke, we will take over. We will overcome. We will. Pandemonium everywhere, baby. And I guarantee you, in every arena throughout the world, I have been to Bangkok. I have seen Habuda Dean, and the dark side is here. The dream lives on. Mulligan, indiscretions you can't hide.
We'll see what'll happen. That's our take five.
It's a real pleasure to have with us right now, three times NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair. In a moment, Ric Flair is going to be wrestling Scott McGee, and I want to tell you about this man, Scott.
Hey, wait just a minute. Now, Gordon, I didn't come out here to talk about who I'm wrestling today. I came out here because Ric Flair, who is only he can do, loves to talk about himself and loves to talk about the World Heavyweight Championship. I came through Florida this time. They said, Flair, Wyndham's going to take you. They said, Rhodes is going to take you. They said, Mulligan's going to take you. Well, I'm walking out of Florida. Woo, that's the way I came in. The World Heavyweight Champion.
Well, I'll tell you.
The vote says, just go. And I told you, Gordon, when I'm talking about myself, I don't like to be interrupted. So I'm going to take this opportunity right now to do a challenging on my own. Next time I come through here, I want Dusty Rhodes, as you say, live and in color. In other words, I want the dream on TV. I figure the only way to really put Dusty Rhodes in the right perspective in this great sport is to humiliate him, as only a great wrestler like myself could do, right there on the television screen.
Well, maybe that's...
Barbara, wait just a minute. I want to talk to Barbara. Wait. Don't interrupt me, Gordon. I want to talk to Barbara. You know, Barbara, it's an establishment. No.